Hi again, everyone. Now we have Pandikrishnan Gurusamy from Lazada.
Thank you. Hi, good morning, everyone. Today my talk is about data masking on MySQL, but we basically do on MariaDB. So I'm the one who is the only one talking other than MySQL today. So
in this room.
So I'm also a big fan of MySQL, so don't take that personally. I work for Lazada. We are one of the e-commerce group in Southeast Asia, and we are a part of Alibaba also. And my talk is about data masking. So, what is data masking? So, it's basically, in some cases we need to change the original data with the random characters or with the random values to share the data outside the companies for third party vendors or something. So for that reason we are using it.
So data masking is good then, because before masking it's 5-digit salary, after masking it's 6-digit salary.
So to protect the confidential data in the test environment, so the reason for the data masking is to do the analytics, market research, development, and then for the PCI compliance, and it varies according to their company needs. So what is sensitive data? So the sensitive data is basically like credit card informations and bank details, and customers' personal informations mostly, and then it also depends on the business needs. So these are the data masking methods which were available for MySQL and which we tried. So first one is PyRepL. So PyRepL is basic, it will capable of doing the data masking, but it is not a very stable one. It is very hard to maintain a PyRepL replication thing. So next is the column level privilege. Column level privilege is it's very simple to use, but the thing is when you have too many users, it is very critical to manage. And then in the test databases, if your application is pointing to the test DBs, then column level privilege won't help in that case. So next one is the proxies. So MariaDB has its own proxy like MaxScale, and then next is proxy SQL. Using the proxy, you can still able to do data masking, but still it won't disadvantage, which I am going to discuss in the next slides. So there are other commercially third party tools were available for doing data masking on MySQL. And then the final method, not a final method, which we figured out and which helped us is triggers. So reason for not using proxy SQL is, in proxy SQL, you cannot able to do a select star on a table when you do a masking on the table. And you need to write a really tough regular expressions things for doing a data masking. So we skipped this proxy SQL. And then the reason for not using MaxScale is, MaxScale has its own disadvantage. Like this kind of query still reveal the personal information, and this kind of queries, you eventually, if you try the random numbers in the var class, still you can able to get it done, because the data inside the database is not fully encrypted or masked. It is only masked in the client side only. So after that, we tried to do, after doing lots of spending lots of time on trying all other tools. We tried to use a simple method. It's triggers. So everybody knows how the trigger will work in statement-based replication. So in our case, we just need to do masking only on the slaves. We don't need to mask or we don't need to encrypt anything on the masters. So if you are using statement-based replication, the statement, the binary log contains the SQL statements, and then that SQL statements will get fired in the slaves, and then that will invoke the triggers.
Why do you don't want to mask
my master? Master, it's a production.
No queries will directly go on the master.
No. Read queries will go to the master, but the environment which is in the master, it's fully a production environment. There we cannot mask anything internally in the database. So that I will show you the setup of ours in the next few slides. So if you are using statement-based replication, this will work very easily. You will just need to create triggers only on the slaves, and then when you insert or when you update something on the masters, the trigger get invoked, and then in the slaves the data will be masked. But if you are using row based replication, that thing won't happen, because in the row based replication the binary logs contains only the row changes. So it won't have the statements which were executed on the master. So for example, if you are using PT online schema change, you will get to know the difference. Because during the time of when you run a PT OSE on a master, it will create three triggers in the master, but that three triggers won't have any effect on the slaves. But still the online schema change will be successful due to the binary log events. So in this case, this is the example for the row-based replication triggers. If you have triggers in the slave, but it won't have any effect on the slaves because of row-based replication. But in our environment, we are totally using row-based replication. In this case, MySQL Percuno servers does not have this feature which we are using, so that we used MariaDB. So MariaDB has this variable, slave run trigger for RBR. So what this will do is, in this kind of situation, when you enable the variable on the slave, so this will trigger the triggers, fire the triggers, and then it will mask the data in the slaves. So it looks like pretty simple. You just need to have your triggers in the slaves and then get it done. So you just need to create a triggers for these two events in your slaves, create update. So if you in this case in the row-based replication in the MariaDB, this is the one. So your data will get masked in the slaves without any issues. But it is very simple when you are using just two tables or very few columns you are masking. But in our environment, we are masking more than 400 columns across 110 tables, so it is very hard to maintain. So what we tried to do is, we just automated all the processes using our write our in-home Python scripts, and then we automated it, and then the adding of the column for the new data masking is a configuration based one. So this is the example for the configuration. So we maintain the config like this: masking method, database name, table name, column name. This is the example. Hash column is the masking method, database name, table name, and then the column name. So we use three kinds of masking methods: hash column, hash phone, hash email. So that means hash column means it will do a MD5 on the column. Hash phone means it will create a random number for that column. Hash email means it will just create a some dummy value on the email column. So our setup is like this. So you ask the question, right? Why we are not running the thing? Because in the production environment, we need a real-time data. We don't want to mask any data in our production environment. So this blue one is our production environment. This is our testing or data science environment. So what we will do is we will, and then the blue ones are our Percona servers. Green ones are the MariaDB. So you can see the legends over there.
My question is, it's a sensitive data that you want to hide it. It should happen on all the servers, because there could be somebody who is directly talking to master and then getting that sensitive.
No, the thing is, in the master and in the production environment, only the application will have the access. This environment will be accessed by the third parties. We will give the data to the third parties for various reasons.
Okay.
That security is usually done in middle there. Not on middle display, usually. I haven't heard of
it. So, yeah, in the middle versions, for in the MySQL case, you can even use the proxies that we discussed in the previous slides, right? The proxy SQL and Mac
so
scale.
You give the data to the third party, you do masking.
No, this is a real-time environment, which these servers were used by our development environment also. So we don't want to reveal our customer information to the developers. So what we will do is, we will deploy all the triggers in this server. So this is act like a master for the testing servers. So from here, it will get replicated to the testing environment and the development environment. So this green ones are MariaDB instances. So for doing this, the challenges are building a new data masking server, which means creating this server is really a time-consuming task if you are having your database size is very huge. So in our environment, our database sizes are really huge. So building initial setup will take quite a long time. And then if you are using PTOSE, then this is another pain. Because whatever you do on the masters, the DDLs needs to be replicated over here, over all this one. The PTOSE will have some issues on this one that I'm going to cover on the next slides, how we handled it. So how to build a new data masking server. So you need to take a backup from the master, and then you need to run an update on all the tables which you intend to mask. For example, in our case, we need to run update on over 110 tables. So, and then enable the slave trigger parameter, and then set up a replication between the masters and the slave. In this case, in our case, we use GTIDs in our Percona servers. The MySQL GTID and MariaDB GTIDs are totally different. But still, you can set up a replication using the native method. But you cannot do vice versa. MariaDB GTID to Percona GTID or MySQL GTID won't work. So these things are mostly what we will do is we have automated scripts for it. When you run the scripts, it will automatically create the update statements and triggers for insert and update events. So we will just try to deploy it on our servers. So what are the challenges of PTOSC? The PTOSC, most of them will know how PTOSC works, right? PTOSC is basically works based on the triggers. In this case, when you use a PTOSC, the replication between the master and slave will get broken whether you are using a whether the table which you are trying to alter is having a masking column or not. Regardless, it will fail. So this is how PTOSC work in row-based replication. So PT in the master, it will that there are three triggers will be created on the master. The same three triggers will be replicated on the slave, but the triggers won't have any effect on the slaves. The inserts, updates, and deletes which are happening in the main table will get forwarded using the triggers to the new the temporary tables. So once the PTOSC is successful, this table get dropped and this temp table get renamed as the old table. So as we have the triggers in the slaves in the RBR environment, what it will happen is the triggers which were created by the PTOSC does not have any effect on the slaves. But as we enable the slave run trigger RBR on the slaves, these triggers get invoked in slaves as well. So it will throw this error and it will break the replication between master and slave. In this case, it is very simple to fix this one. You just need to drop the triggers which were created by the PTOSC only on slaves. Once you drop the triggers which were created by the PTOSC on the slaves, and then if you start the replication, it works fine, because the triggers won't have any effect on the slaves for the PTOSC. The online schema change will be happened using the bin log events.
But it's always recommended to make master and slave in the same sync, because you never know what is the updates that are happening on the master and at any time on the slave. So general recommendation is master and slave should be in sync, whether it's a DDL.
No, it is in sync only.
So you have dropped the tape.
No, we are just dropping the triggers.
Which is existing on the master.
Yeah, which is existing on the master. The reason for dropping the triggers is the trigger won't have any effect on the slaves. So this is the way PTOSC works in the row-based environment. These triggers will still present in the slaves, but the triggers won't get invoked on the slaves. The events, the updates and inserts happening on this one will be forwarded to this temp table using triggers. But in this case of slave, the new table get the data from the bin log events, not from the triggers. So if you drop the triggers, it won't be any issue. The next scenario is when you are running a PTOSC on the table which is having a data masking column. In that case, what will happen is we need to. So as I mentioned previously, so if you go back to this slide, you can see this table has before PTOSC was successful, this table has a masked data. But this table does not have a mask data due to it is directly directly replicated from master to slave using binlog events. So when the PTOSE is successful, this table got dropped and this temp table will be replaced as a old table. So in this case, the columns which you were masked on this table won't exist, because this has a unmasked data from the masters. So in that case, what you need to do is you need to stop the slave and then update the table with the you need to run an update command for masking the columns. After that, you need to deploy the triggers for that table and then start the replication. So these things also will be handled by our automated scripts. So this is the example for that one. So this has a masked data, and then this one has a unmasked data because it is directly coming from the master. So in that one, the masked data, this table got dropped, and unmasked data which is existing in the temp table will become an original table. So in that case, what you need to do is you need to run the update command and then create a trigger for the tables and then start the slave. So all this process were fully automated, and we were deployed and we were successfully running this whole project for more than 2 years. So still now we don't have any major issues for this one. So all the scripts were available on the GitHub. So you are welcome to download it and use it if you guys want. Thank you.
Thank you. Do you have any questions before we clap? No? Then we can clap. Thank you so much.